brothers and sisters, we remind and encourage all persons in the sanctuary to follow the safety protocols and be guided by the members of our hospitality team. Please follow the arrow signs that direct the flow into and out of the sanctuary. The main door is to be used as the entrance and may also be used to exit the sanctuary. The side doors should be used for exiting the sanctuary only. The ramp at the eastern side door shall only be used as an entrance for persons who require wheelchair access or are unable to mount the steps to the main door. Please be diligent in observing the physical distancing requirements of 3 feet between persons who are not members of your household. For our safety, we are requesting that persons sanitize their hands each time they enter the sanctuary. Please remember to wear your face mask for the duration of the service, covering both your nose and mouth. While inside the sanctuary, you are permitted to remove your face mask for the following purposes only: to partake of the sacrament of Holy Communion, to read a lesson or deliver a sermon, tribute, eulogy, or any other reading or form of oral expression from the lectern or pulpit, to sing or to play a woodwind or brass instrument with appropriate physical distancing. If you have any queries or require any clarification on the current safety protocols in place for in-person worship, please speak with a member of the hospitality team on duty for this service. We thank you for your role in ensuring that our sanctuary remains a safe space.
Bless you, good morning, brothers and sisters. Please stand as we begin our service of thanksgiving and celebration for the life of our deceased sister, Cynthia Pauline Thompson. We join our voices in the processional hymn, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky."
Yeah.
resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The hour is coming, and it now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live.
We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Our Savior Christ Jesus abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell.
Because I live, you will live also, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain, for the first things are passed away. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we turn to you in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you, and may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit minister to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave us the pledge of eternal life, lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us join our voices as we sing the hymn, "Through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy."
Thank you.
Bless a good morning to all who are gathered in the sanctuary this morning. I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, head of the church, God of comfort and peace. Let me extend warm Christian greetings and welcome to the president, our president of Barbados, Her Excellency, the most honorable Dame Sandra Mason. Welcome to you, ma'am. Our Prime Minister, the Honorable Mia Amor-Montley, the members of Cabinet, President of the Senate, His Honor Reginald Farley, members of the Judiciary, members of the Senate, members of the House of Assembly, diplomatic representatives, the Dame Billy Miller, Sir Richard Cheltenham, and Lady Cheltenham, Dr. the Most Honorable Anthony Gabby Carter, Sir Gordon Greenidge and partner, former ministers and members of Parliament. Welcome to you all this morning as we come together to give God thanks and to celebrate the life of a true matriarch, a woman of the faith, our departed sister, Cynthia Pauline Thompson. I also want to extend sincere condolences on behalf of the Bishop and Superintendent Minister of the Methodist Church here in Barbados and across the South Caribbean, the Reverend Derek Richards, all other ministers, the entire Methodist community of faith, to Everton, Elizabeth, Patricia, Edwin, and Arlene. And we prayed God's comfort upon you during this time of bereavement. And we remind you that the church doors are always open. We are available to you if there's any need for you to come for any counseling and comfort. And you're assured of our continued prayers throughout this period of bereavement. So welcome to you all, and may God's Spirit be with us as we join together in worship. We are met in this solemn moment to commend Cynthia Pauline Thompson into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our deceased sister, as we first hear a musical tribute Lamb of God by Mrs. Annette Bruce, followed by an appreciation by Liz Thompson, in that order.
Lamb of God, oh Lamb of God,
members of the clergy, Your Excellency, the Most Honorable Dame Sandra Mason, Prime Minister of Barbados, the Honorable Mayor Motley, you will forgive me if I do not extend the precedence list because the order of precedence has just been established. In the hours before Jesus Christ's crucifixion, he said, "Would that this cup could pass from me, but thy will, not mine, be done." And today I repeat the words of my Savior in the church where my mother worshipped for over 50 years and where we grew up in the Sunday school. "Would that this cup could pass from me, but thy will, O God, not mine, be done." I say these words, the welcome and this appreciation of my mother at the insistence of my sister who asked me to speak on behalf of the family. So I ask you to join with me and with my brothers, my brother and sisters, as we celebrate the life of our mother, Cynthia Pauline Thompson, as we mourn her passing, and as we honor this rock. You know, over the course of the last couple weeks, one of the words, or some of the words that people repeatedly said to me is, "Your mother was amazing. She was such a gem. She was a lady. She was so dignified." Jerry Thorne, the son to whom she did not give birth, put it best, Jerry. "You said to me, your mother was the quintessential Barbadian of her era, dignified, generous, gracious, caring." She was all of those. But Pat has said to me that Mummy asked that on this occasion she should step out of Dad's shadow, and that we should let you see her not in the way people are normally eulogized as saints, but that you should see her for the person that she was. I could give you the biographical details. I could tell you that she was born on a Tuesday, on the 23rd of September, 1924, and that she died on a Friday morning at sunrise, on the 28th of January, 2022. I could tell you that she gave birth to five children. My sister, Etwin, who is unable to be with us from London. Etwin, my darling, I know that you are here in spirit. Her next child was Arlene, who came in from London for the funeral. My brother, Everton, is here. And those were the three children of her first marriage. Many of you don't know them, some of you do. And then Pat and I, from the relationship with Henry Everson Thompson, or Harry. She was one of six children. Sheila, Derry, and Rani, her siblings, predeceased her. But Jean and Imogen, really, and Eulene, both now very advanced in years, are still very much alive. And Auntie Eulene certainly is in good spirit, if not in the best of health. I have a friend who says that when you write the person's lifetime, you give the date of birth, you put a dash, and then you put the date of death. And he said it's not the date of the birth and the death that's important. It is that dash. It is the time in between. And so today, I don't want to fill you with biographical details. I want to share with you a few stories that tell you who my mother was. Some of you are here today because you know her from her business. My mother was a businesswoman. She established a business in Barbados nearly 60 years ago, perhaps 55 years ago, Cermak Laundry. It was her husband's dream, her partner's dream and vision, and together they worked to build this business. My father was focused on the profits. My mother was focused on the people. You see, she was about customer service. My mother loved people, and therefore getting a shirt just right, creasing the shirt sleeve perfectly, and the customer smiling with satisfaction was what drove my mother, what made her stay up late, what made her work for excellence, what made her cause this laundry to become one of the most successful laundries in the country. For my father, it was the ka-ching of the cash register. But for mommy, it was the people and the service. And somebody had to mind the account, so I understand what drove dad. He was the visionary. He understood that every Friday staff had to be paid, so that he did what needed to be done. But mommy was charming. She was disciplined. People would come in to see her, and she would engage them in conversation when their clothes weren't ready, so they didn't even know that the shirts or the pants were being pressed rapidly while she was chatting them up. Dad was her partner of over 60 years, and I say partner, they met around 1948. She then had three children, the two older ones, and Everton was a baby. And we don't think of our parents as romantic beings, but I think that they were the love of each other's lives. I didn't realize how much my father loved my mother until she became ill, and I saw him weep till he could not stand, till he could not speak, till he didn't know what to do with himself. But I knew how much my mother loved my father because of the way she cared for him every day of her life. He died in her arms in 2013. I knew she loved him because of the way mom gave up herself. She was a trained cosmetician in London. She was asked about modeling. Dad said no, so she said no. She made shampoos and conditioners which people bought. They were very high quality. But that took time away from the laundry. So Daddy said, Pauline, you got to give that up. And she did. So when Daddy was honored at the millennium for his successful business, the truth is Mommy should have been honored too. Prime Minister, I'm not complaining. I'm simply saying that we pay tribute to what men achieve, but Daddy could not have been successful without Mom. She was the engine that drove that business. Dad was the brain. Dad was a skilled engineer. But my mother was the energy, the emotion, the passion. When Dad was going to give up, when the laundry was burnt to the ground in the 60s, it was why when he and Mom fell out, ladies loved Daddy and Daddy loved ladies, and Mommy got tired and she said, I'm done with this, Harry, and she packed up my little sister Pat and moved back to England. And Pat said, I must tell the truth. And Dad went to England and said, I cannot live without you. Cannot live without you. And Mom came back and they were never parted until he died. And I say this because romances are not perfect. Relationships are not perfect. We have to learn to work with these people whom we choose. She had a crooked finger. She got it during the war. She was going for oil to cook for the children. She fell on her bicycle outside Government Hill near Government House, as it was then. Got her finger sliced open. Poor black woman in Barbados, poor medical care. The finger was permanently crooked. When she was pregnant with Everton, she worked as a maid in Strathclyde. She tied her stomach and concealed the pregnancy because by then her first husband had left her. And if she did not work, her children could not eat. And those were the days that my sisters and brother, well, he was a baby, could not go into Strathclyde because whites only after a certain time. My mother died an unrepentant supporter of the Barbados Labour Party. She was so determined that the BLP should be re-elected and Mia, as she would say, become Prime Minister again, that on the 19th of January, though my mother had to be lifted into a vehicle, she was one of the oldest people to vote in Barbados. She wore a beige striped dress. And I said, Mommy, are you sure? And she said, Liz, I am going. And Senator Crystal Haynes came because I couldn't get her into the SUV. And she went, and I'll tell you why. You see, my father's sister was the first female MP, but it was from my mother that I learned the transformational possibilities of politics and that politics is an honorable profession. She told me how hard her life was, how shop assistants worked late nights and maids had no time off, that she worked in kitchens where she could not eat the food and she would smell the bacon frying and be hungry because she had fed her children but couldn't feed herself and she didn't know what bacon tasted like, but she cooked it and she served it, yes sir, yes ma'am, and smiled and stepped back from the table and went back to the kitchen. But when Grantley Adams came, her life changed. So my mother became a Labour Party and I understood what it meant for a politician to change a person's life. And it is the tradition by which I have lived, and it is the tradition, Prime Minister, I know, by which you live. My mother was a woman of deep, deep faith. Every time the doctor said, well, listen, Pat, I'm terribly sorry, Mummy would smile and say, dear God, till it reached the point where I said, well, Adrian Lord, or said, Adrian, what you think? He said, listen, with anybody else, I would call it, but not with your mother. And when the doctor said to me, come home, your mother has days to live, maybe hours, and I flew into Barbados, Mummy greeted me with a warm smile. And she lived for another 20 months. She was part of the Windrush generation. She and Dad went to England. Daddy became the first one, the first black signalman on the train station, on the train system. Mummy became a supervisor at Selfridges. They bought a house as black people in London in the 1960s. I told you she did hairdressing. She had to give up the dream of modeling. Some of you are here because Mummy used to cook and give you. The Prime Minister says that my mother made the best macaroni pie she ever tasted in her whole life, and she was right. She made excellent conkeys. She cooked, and the kitchen was a place of warmth and aroma, and where we got together, had discussions, whether it was about politics or things happening in life, we would be there, and Mummy would be at the center of it all. She loved her grandchildren and great-grandchildren dearly, and last year, November, when Edwin's son John passed, Mummy was devastated that she was too physically unwell, and because of COVID, she was unable to travel. She mothered many other people, Clara and Shandy and Renee and David, and also Hoyt and many, many others. My mother made friends, and made friends easily. You go in at HMB, how your mother? Tell she I say hello. You go into Carter's, oh, Mummy, tell her Mary say hi. People from Pricemart came to the viewing. Can't believe your mother died. She used to come and buy XYZ from me. You're going to Fanny. Hi, how are you? How's Mom? I went in there a few days ago. Oh, Mummy, she's passed. Well, how you mean pass? And they told the whole staff, and so that was the nature of the person she was. And so you were as likely to come home and find a surgeon, a judge, a big up in Barbados at her kitchen table eating, talking, as you were to find somebody from NCC or SSA. She treated everybody the same. She was a very elegant dresser, fashionista, and she loved hats. I think she gave some sense of style to both Pat and me, but I think that Pat outdoes me always. I explained to you that my mother was really born in poverty in a very difficult time, and she left her children here in Barbados and went to England with my father, with whom she was then involved, to make a better life, and then she brought the children to the UK, and when Daddy decided to come back, she came back with her, as I said, she was pregnant with Pat when she came home, and I was already born. But because we were born, Pat and I, and you know, life is funny, it could easily have been the other way around with those children being born in the time when Mummy was better off. When Mummy saw money and the business started to do well, Mummy was generous with us to a fault. But she was also a Renaissance woman. She learned to crochet. She went to floral arranging at the YWCA. She learned to play the piano. She did gardening and floral arranging and ballroom dancing because she loved music and art. And for the first time, she was able to express herself because She had gone into the maid service at 13 years old. 13 years, and she was a bright girl at school. She was living with her uncle who had money, but her mother needed income in the house, so she took her from her uncle's home and took her back. She was in St. George, took her back to urban Barbados and put her to work. And my mother worked very hard. She suffered and suffered a lot of abuse. But she had a lot of spunk in her. She was a woman of very firm convictions. When I kept telling you, every time the doctors gave her up for dead, and this happened years ago too, when they said she wouldn't make it, she said, "God, I believe you are going to heal me. I want to see Janelle grow up." And so it was. And so Pat and I get our faith from her. She was highly protective of her children. When Everton was at war, he was the first Black sergeant major in the British paratroopers, and Edwin also got her sense of care, and she counsels from my mother. She would cry and pray for Everton constantly, cry and pray, listening for news in those days to know he was safe and he was well. She advised many people, mentored many people, just reached out to many people. But Mommy was also very protective of her children. I remember one morning standing in the kitchen and hearing my mother scream and fly out of the house, and I did not know what happened. Mom, watching Pat walk down to the university, saw a man about to assault her, and my mother went for that man. But it wasn't the first time she rose to Pat's defense with violence. We were walking in London one day. We were small. Mommy had just bought a set of kitchen knives. And a Caucasian couple came up to us and bounced Pat, and Pat staggered and nearly fell. Mom was livid. Mommy said, "Children, wait there," and she pulled one of the knives. Well, the young man who was laughing when Pat's falling stopped laughing, because my mother raised the knife and went for him. Pat and I stood there screaming, but this boy took off. Hussein Bolt could not have caught him that day. He flew, and my mother was behind him, and Pat and I started to scream. And Mommy looked back and realized what was happening. And she said, and turned and came back to her children. I think we've all inherited that kind of fierceness, and we are grateful for it. She found it difficult. I told you she mentored and cared for a lot of people. A young lady stopped Pat and said, "I'm so sorry to hear of your mother." And she started to cry. She said, "One day your mother came to where I was working, and I was going to commit suicide. My life was so bad." And she said, "Your mother stayed with me, counseled me, told me things that she had gone through that were way worse than some of the things I was going through. She prayed with me. She talked to me about God. And when she was finished, I couldn't kill myself no more." She said, "And you know what? She took my phone number and she stayed in touch with me." And my mother called even when she was ill. She canvassed for Ralph Thorne in 2018 on the telephone, her little black book with phone numbers. "Hi, Mary. Well, you know Ralph Thorne running up by you." She likes the thorns. So she was committed to any cause to which she gave herself. She never forgot her roots. Pat was the only child living here with Mom, and she organized a spectacular 95th birthday celebration with historic tours, fine dining events, trips all over the place. And Mommy loved socializing because she loved people and because it gave her a chance to dress up. And Mommy was at all the events till late at night. In fact, on the night we went to Oyston's at 2 o'clock in the morning, when the young people were dropping down, we were saying, "Mommy, please, let's go home now. Mommy, please, please." One night the grandchildren came over and the great grands, and she taught them how to make rum punches. And she said, "Well, y'all can carry them back to England." The next morning, every bottle of rum punch was empty and the grandchildren could not be roused. Mummy couldn't get accustomed to the technology. She had difficulty using her phone. So she had to go overseas for a treatment, and I gave her, this was a little while ago, I gave her a phone and said, Mummy, please call me, let me know that you're well. I got no call from Mom. I went into panic. I could not reach her doctors. I didn't know what to do. I finally reached the doctor like 36 hours after. He says, but your mother's fine. I reached Mommy the next day. I said, Mommy, where are you? What are you doing? She says, I'm at breakfast with your father. I said, Mommy, at breakfast? But Pat and I are here going mad. I've been calling you and calling you. She said, calling me? Well, listen, that phone and ring once. All it do is play music all day long. Didn't know the ringtone. One night I went out fetting, got back home very late. It's quarter to six or thereabout. Mummy was in the garden. I did not know then that a mother stayed up all night wondering if her girl child was safe. I did not know that she was in her garden because she didn't know where else to be. There were no cell phones and she couldn't find her child. I was left to go to a party. So I was surprised to find her in the garden. I didn't know what to do. Good night, Mom. Morning, Liz. How are you? A surprise to see you in the garden. Liz, go inside. Yes, Mom, I'm going to get some sleep. Good night. Liz, it is morning, and I'm not raising worthless women. Only worthless women let the sun shine on them in the beds early in the morning. You go inside, take off your clothes, and come out here. I got work for you to do. Understand? And bed first. Yes, Mom. Liz Thompson, I smell cigarette smoke in this house and it can only be you. There are to be no cigarettes in this house. That was it. I never smoked herb. I did drink. I did not smoke cigarettes. Mummy had laid down the law. There were to be no cigarettes in her house. Full stop. I could keep regaling you with stories, but I won't. I just want to say thank you to Bishop Richards for his pastoring of my mother. If any of you are looking for a church, come here. Apart from being an excellent preacher, you can call him at any hour. When he came to give Mummy communion, he would sing hymns with her, he would talk with her, he would stay until she felt fully ministered to. And he does that with everyone, he and Reverend Allison. I was grateful that the last time he gave her communion, I rushed from home to join her. On the night that Mummy died, Pat and I stood at either side of her bed. She knew that she was going. She called every member of the family one by one and blessed them at about midnight and prayed for them and prayed for her soul and sang hymns. And at 6:09, with Pat and I praying and singing hymns, the woman who gave us life returned to the God who gave her life. 6:09 in the morning, slipped into it peacefully, which was what she had always prayed for. I thank Tara and her children for their care. I thank Jerry and the Queen Elizabeth Hospital and Dr. Lord and Dr. Massey and Dr. Moe for their care. I thank Johnny. I don't want to go back to the politics, but Johnny had a very, very special relationship with my mother, and so did Dame Billy, and I thank them all. I thank all of you who came, all of you who contributed to the richness of the fabric of Mom's life, who made it special for her, and by extension, made it special for us. Pat and I will seek and find comfort and the God about whom Mom taught us from the time we were very small. I shared with her, I gave her a big print Bible, it is in the casket with her, and I highlighted my favorite Bible passage. I told her this on the night that she was dying. The last word she said to me was, Liz. She turned to me, I was on the other side of everybody else. She said, Liz, yes, Mom, I gone here? I said, I know, Mom. And I love you. She said, I love you too. She told Pat and I want to be free now. And we knew that we had to release her. And we did. Fear not, Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. The Bible sits at my mother's feet. The Word of God says that the Word of God is a lamp unto your feet. May that light shine on her. May God's perpetual light shine on her as that embraces her. And until we join her, rest in peace, Mommy.
Let us continue our thanksgiving for the life of our dear sister, Cynthia. As we sing the hymn, Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I'm tired, I'm weak, I'm worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, Precious Lord, lead me home. A hymn of comfort, and I understand that this is the hymn, as our Bishop Derek has said, that our sister sung just before she passed away, invoking God's presence to take her with him. And I believe she knew that she had one of those promised mansions that he said he will give to those who remain victorious in him. So let us stand as we celebrate and give God thanks for our dear sister's life and leadership as we sing, Precious Lord, take my hand.
Yeah.
We hear now a self-penned poem from Janelle Evelyn, followed then by a musical tribute by saxophonist Mylon Clark.
Protocols having been established, good morning. When she was angry, the thunderous sound of Harry would shake the walls of 51 Stead. All right, Paul, was the replying retort as Henry quietly but quickly retreated from the battlefield. But Paul, Pauline, Cynthia, she was a warrior. She always stood her ground and would not be moved. All hail the strong watchtower. The monkey blood, the monkey blood, the monkey blood. Heard of it as a child, but never quite understood it. Looking back now, I know. Cruising up the ABC highway, I could only have been but 8. A reckless driver suddenly cuts Nan off, causing her to swerve. That was a mistake. I couldn't clock the speed. Thank God, neither did the law. But what I can tell you was that there was an exponential rise in the monkey blood. And many a lesson was learnt that day. I'll let sleeping dogs lie. All hail the strong watchtower. She was a woman of the soil. And if some could boast of having a green thumb, then she had 10 green fingers. Nanny had an intimate relationship with every plant, tree, and shrub in her garden. To see them suffer, and yes, I mean the plants, was like to wound her. She cared for them so deeply. Like the scriptures say, if God cares for the birds and bees, then how much more for us, his creations? So too Nanny, just as she cared for her plants, she cared for her children more. Happy am I to have been a part of her garden. All hail the strong watchtower. Ever heard of the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker? Have you ever tried to be the chief cook and bottle washer? Well, Cynthia could do it all. She was the Wonder Woman of her time. And rode a Lambret scooter just to prove it. In her kitchen were clear signs of warning. Make sure brain is engaged before putting mouth into gear. Or, in this kitchen, there is only one finger in the pot, mine, with a capital M, I might add. She was an exceptional cook and baker. Many to this day can attest to her skill, including our Prime Minister. Many a daughter have tried to match it. Yes, she's yet to be defeated. All hail the strong watchtower. Ebony skin as smooth as silk, and gentle was her touch. I often wondered how your hands and knees toil so hard the wooden floors of many a great house, yet there you stood without imperfection. Your aroma smelled of home, baked goods, and sweet pastures. Your manners, grace, and charm could rival any royal. You were, to me, the epitome of a queen. All hail the strong watchtower. So many a place I have traversed where you had already left your mark. So many were they who stopped to tell me of your good deeds and how you had impacted their lives, never to cause to suffer those who were in need of what you gave freely without asking return. How do you fill the shoes of a giant? All hail the strong watchtower. Daughter, sister, aunt, wife, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, great-great-grandmother, friend, businesswoman, entrepreneur, and humble servant. So many were the hats that you wore, iconic not only in your fashionable style, gloves, bag, shoes. In fact, there's not much that I'm wearing that is mine. iconic not only in your fashionable style and your well-done nails, but iconic in heart and spirit. A wife of noble character, who can find? Henry did. The woman among women, a ruby among the stones. Plentiful are the fruits of your vineyard, and your works will always be praised at the gates. All hail the strong watchtower. Cynthia, Pauline Thompson, all hail the strong watchtower. Thank you.
Humble trust, hear the words of Holy Scripture as we hear readings from Romans chapter 8 by Brother Gentile Harris, followed by the responses, Psalm 16, which will be led by Dame Billy Miller, and then the Gospel from John chapter 14, which will be read by Yashande Burton.
The epistle reading comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of God.
The ministry of the word. We are treating Psalm 16 responsively. I will speak, and then the congregation will speak. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom is all my delight. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also, my heart instructs me. Therefore, my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Gospel is according to John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6 and verses 27. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave you with. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Congregation may be seated as we hear a musical tribute, Well Done, by Dr. the Most Honorable Auntie the Mighty Gabby Carter, after which you'll hear the message from the Bishop, Reverend Derek A. Richards.
Morning, church. I just want to say that Ms. Thompson has been my friend for 63 and my 73 years. I will never forget when Mike called me, Mike Harris, and he said, we're celebrating Mom's birthday. We want you to come. I said, it already happened. Because I can be there. And I remember how we were at the house, and then on the other occasion, we went to Baxter's Road, almost opposite where this Sir Matt Laundry was. And when I got there and I finished, Ms. Thompson said, where are you going? I said, well, I got another engagement. She said, not before you take out them conkeys in the back there. Because she was so generous a person. My deep sympathy to the family. Life is a stage we live on, fully engaged since we born, playing a role that we've been given by the Creator who watches on. Sometimes it seems life is hard. You will receive only bad. Don't be afraid. Don't give up the struggle. Keep your head high, you will get by, and you will be playing your role well. You will be avoiding hell, and at the end of your days, at your setting sun, the Creator will say to you, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done. Act two will come, be prepared. Sadness and bliss will be shared.
then suddenly things will get better. Don't be complacent, see the future, save all you can, fill your need, but don't ever sow seeds of greed. Love your neighbor as you love your person. Life will be complete. Life will be sweet. And you will be playing your role well. You will be avoiding hell. And at the end of your days, at your setting sun, the Creator will say to you, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done. Father time creeping on you down the line. Don't be ashamed when you no longer can rendezvous like youngsters do. Show them the ways of the world. Help them avoid life's pitfalls. Helping them through is really helping your own offspring do the same thing. And you will be playing your role well. Oh, you will be avoiding. And at the end of your days, at your setting sun, the Creator will say to you, well done, well done, well done, well done. Thompson, you brought me to tears. I have known you for all of 63 years. This is a fact. When you first started this sermon, and you and your husband, they were so kind to me. Your guarantee when I brought my uncle's clothes to be loved. And you always showed so much love and so much care. And so I stand here in this church this morning, and I open my mouth and I sing, Miss Thompson, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done, well done.
The clergy for allowing me this moment. Thank you so very much, the Most Honorable Gabby. I want to thank Brother Ryan Boyce who is leading the band today. This is the church organist, and he is excellent. But I came back really to correct a very serious omission on my part. For those of you who have had people who are acutely ill, who have needed 24-hour nursing care, especially when that physical illness is coupled with dementia, you know how difficult it is. I did not thank my mother's nurses. I will ask them to rise and be recognized. Livy, Dami, Innocent. I particularly didn't want to leave this undone. These three young people, I cannot pronounce their names. They're all African. They were my mother's caregivers. Livy was with us when mommy died, and the love, the care. They are from Healing Hands Home Care, led by Lyndon Tempro. But I wanted to thank you and acknowledge you publicly for the care that you gave to my mother. It was exceptional. We don't know what is happening in Barbados, some of us. These African brothers and sisters are learning to be doctors. And they are also trained nurses, and they're working here in Barbados, augmenting the care system, giving private care, giving care in the hospital and in the various institutions, and doing exceptional work. And I really, especially because of recent events, did not want this opportunity to pass without letting them know how truly grateful my family is to you. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
President of Barbados, Excellency the Most Honorable Dame Sandra Mason, Prime Minister of Barbados, the Honorable Mia Amo Motley, brothers and sisters, Everton, Elizabeth, Patricia, Edwin, and Arlene, your spouses, children, grandchildren, and other relatives and friends, I greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, head of the church and savior of the whole world. Let me again take this opportunity to extend condolences on behalf of the Methodist community here in Barbados and across the Southern Caribbean to the family of our beloved sister, Pauline. It is our prayer that you may find strength in God's sustaining grace and power, and be assured of our continued prayers and support as you navigate this season of grief and bereavement. I've decided to share with us a word from Joshua, chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, and it reads, "After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, 'My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all the people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the Israelites.' Let us pray. God, our God, we bless you and give you thanks that your word never returns unto you void, but always accomplishes your purposes. We pray, therefore, that your word will accomplish something in this place, in our hearts, in our lives, in memory of our beloved sister Pauline. Use me, Lord God, to speak for you. Let your word come forth with power and conviction, with grace and with simplicity. Speak as only you alone can. Let the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen. Moses, my servant, is dead. With the death of a great leader, close friend, or confidant, people understandably become anxious and fearful. At no time in human history was this more relevant and pressing than when Moses died. This was more than merely the passing away of a significant leader. Moses was undeniably the greatest and most influential of all Old Testament saints. Not Abraham, not Joseph, not David or Solomon or David, but Moses. Listen to what is said of him in the last three verses of the final chapter of Deuteronomy. And there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, none like him for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his servants and to all his land, and for all the mighty power and all the great deeds of terror that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. Try to imagine the dismay. Try to imagine the dismay, perhaps even the despair that fell upon Israel, upon the word that Moses had died. What will we do now? Where will we go? How shall we survive? Who will lead us now? What did they really hear when they were told that Moses had died? For most of them, this marked the end of an era, an important era. Moses was among the last surviving Israelites who were part of the Exodus. Those who were born in Egypt, born into slavery. Those who had experienced the tyranny of the Egyptians and of the Pharaohs. Those who also had experienced the birth of new hope with the crossing of the Red Sea. Moses' death marked the end of a generation of nation builders. By that time, that entire generation had died and left the generation that was born in the wilderness to move forward. So for them, Moses was much more important than simply the leader of Israel. He was the only leader that many of them knew. You therefore had people in their 40s who only knew Moses as their leader. Everything they knew was informed by his leadership. Everything that they believed was inspired by Moses. He was the liberator, the one who confronted the evil of slavery and led them into freedom. He was the great lawgiver under God. He had helped to form community and to order the lives of the people so that they can live together in unity. He was their intercessor. He prayed for Israel, and he represented the people before God as he went on the mountain and had these conversations with God. He was their prophet and priest, and he led them in worship, the worship of God again and again. He was their counselor and judge, and helped to settle many disputes among the people. He was the miracle worker, the one who pointed them to all that is possible under God. He was the one through whom God had provided, even miraculously, reminding them that little is much when God is in it. Every aspect of their lives and living were impacted by Moses. He had touched the lives of everyone waiting to cross into the land of promise. As a result, they're anxious about the future without Moses. Who will lead us? Who will counsel us? Who will pray for us? Who will stand by us? Who will encourage us? My brothers and sisters, our dear sister Pauline, as far as I know, never held high public office. Apart from the business that she owned and operated, I am not aware that she led any organization or group. But I can tell you this, that I have not met a greater transformational leader than the one that Pauline was during her lifetime. And so today, even as we wait in this place, the news has rung out that Pauline has died. Pauline has died, just as it was said of Moses, "Moses, my servant, is dead." So too, we receive the news that Pauline, the servant of God, is dead. It is significant, my friends, that with all the things that Moses accomplished, the things that God had called Israel to celebrate the most, was the fact that Moses was the servant of the Lord. Today I can testify that Pauline was a servant of the Most High God. She interpreted life through the lens of her faith. She was a strong woman of God. She loved the Lord her God to the very end. She knew the Lord, served the Lord, and loved him with all her being, with all her heart, and interpreted every season and everything in her life through the lens of faith. Therefore, for her, death is not the end. For the Word of God tells us that death is not the end of those who believe in God. Death is not a destination, but a part of the journey of life for those who believe and trust in the Lord. I hear the psalmist saying, as he declared, "He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake." Hear this and hear me well. Though I go through the valley of the shadow of death. And so the psalmist is also saying to us that death is not a destination. For he says, God leads me in the path of righteousness. And the path of righteousness passes through the valley of the shadow of death. And therefore, death is not the destination. Death is simply a part of the journey of life. For those who believe and trust in God, death happens on the path of righteousness. Death is not the end for those who believe. And so we hear Jesus in the gospel that was read, talking about his own death, and Jesus saying to his disciples, I am going away, but I'm going away with purpose. I'm going away to do. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again and take you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Sister Thompson, Pauline, had some health challenges, but she never allowed those health challenges to keep her from praising her God and even joining with us here in this faith community to worship God, because she interpreted life through the lens of faith. Last November, when I told her that our harvest was going to be on the third Sunday of November, she turned to her daughter and said, "I want to go." And surely she was here, sitting right over there in her usual place, lifting her hands and worshiping the Lord, her God. The hymns for this service were chosen by her. That is one of the marks of faith that I have experienced again and again in many who believe in Jesus Christ, and I can speak of those who are Methodists. I've had the privilege of meeting some Methodists, some senior Methodists whose faith in God is so pronounced, whose faith in God is so deep that they're comfortable talking about death because they understand that death is not an end. They understand that death is a part of the journey. They understand, like St. Paul, who said, I am persuaded that neither life nor death, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, hear what, can separate me from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. And so she indicated the hymns she would want to be used to celebrate her life as she transitions from life to life. God told Joshua, Moses was dead. That Moses was dead in order to make the point that they cannot remain where they were forever. And neither could they go back to the place from which Moses had brought their parents. Moses was dead, but the vision of God for Israel was not dead. Moses was dead, but the vision that God had given to Moses for all of Israel was not dead. Moses completed his chapter of the book, but the narrative was not yet completed. There were still empty pages to be written, yes, to be written by the next generation. Moses had brought them to the edge of the wilderness where they could see the land of promise, but they had to enter that land and someone needed to lead them. My brothers and sisters, Pauline Thompson has also done what she could during her lifetime, but the vision of her life was so big that she was not able to complete it herself. But she did what she could by the grace of God. I'm getting somewhere here. I am speaking, therefore, to those who shared in Pauline's life. I'm speaking to those who experienced her love, those whose lives were touched by her life. I'm speaking to her children and grandchildren. I'm speaking to those who encountered her from day to day. And I'm saying that you must continue Pauline's legacy. I'm saying that you must now continue to journey in fulfilling the vision of her life. You must now continue to go in the direction that enables you to accomplish the things that she envisioned for her family, for her church, for her world, for her nation. When you look at the latter stages of Moses' life, you would discover that Moses was very deliberate and intentional in mentoring Joshua for leadership. Moses spent the last years of his life passing the baton to Joshua and Joshua's generation. That, my brothers and sisters, is a mark of a great man, a great woman. That, my brothers and sisters, is a mark of a great parent. That, my brothers and sisters, is a mark of a great leader. That, my brothers and sisters, is a mark of a great citizen. I'm always reminding myself that a real test of my leadership is not how many followers I have, but the number of leaders that I enable. What I am saying to all of us
that it is our responsibility to nurture the next generation deliberately and intentionally, as Moses would have done, as Pauline would have done, and as so many men and women called by the name of Jesus would have done over the years. We must be deliberate in wherever we are placed, in whatever we do, to be deliberate, to be intentional in grooming and nurturing the next generation to be as successful and even more successful than we have been. A great leader does not die with a baton in their hands. Great leaders do not die with a baton in their hand. Great leaders ensure that the baton is passed to the next generation of competent men and women who are able to serve with distinction and with grace. Pauline seemed very deliberate in passing the baton to her children and grandchildren during the last several years. And as we heard from her daughter moments ago, before she died, she had the family around the bed. And she went from one person to the other and gave a word of encouragement, a word of challenge, and she blessed them. Oh, that is, my brothers and sisters, the example of great leadership, of ensuring that the next generation stands firm, of ensuring that the next generation takes the mantle and run their part of the race. And so Pauline, like Paul could have said, I've run the race, I've kept the faith, and now there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. But those who are coming behind must recognize that they too must run their race well. And therefore, I'm challenging the next generation of the Thompsons. I'm challenging you to take the baton and to run your race, to run your leg, to do so with all your strength and zeal and energy, to do so with all your heart for the glory of God and for the well-being of the next generation. I wish to remind you, therefore, that all of us have an opportunity to shape the next generation. As a matter of fact, whether we accept it or not, our lives, our decisions are going to help to shape the next generation. You know, at a time when many in our world had become insular, self-centered, and even selfish, COVID-19 happened, and the global climate crisis was further highlighted and brought us back to the stark reality that we are connected. One person's decision affects the entire nation, the entire world, the entire community, the entire family. Friends, we are shaping the next generation with every breath that we take. And therefore, we must be as deliberate about it as Pauline was. With every person that she met, she took a personal interest in them. And it was never about her. It was always about, how do I help in this situation? How do I make this context better? How do I make this reality a better one? It is all of our responsibility to ensure that the next generation is shaped in a way that secures our future and ensures our greatness and our faithfulness. At a time when so many things are happening in our world, each one of us must step up and say, I will make a difference. So as I said, COVID-19 has taught us that the decisions I make affect others, including the people I love and care about. And therefore, I must determine in myself that as for me, I'm going to make the best decisions for the well-being of all. I'm of the firm conviction that the next generation must always excel above and beyond the previous generation, that every generation must start on the shoulders of the generation before. So the question is, what are you going to do with the legacy of Pauline Thompson? How are you going to allow her legacy and her life to shape you to become the best that you can be, to shape you so that you can intentionally shape the next generation? I want to end by saying that part of Pauline's legacy is in this place, this church, this community of faith, the worship life of this place, and by extension, the transformation of the city. And therefore, I'm calling on all of us, especially those of us who grew up here, those of us whose lives were touched by the ministries of this church, those of us who at one time or another were nurtured by this faith community. And you may be at different places in your journey, but guess what? We accompany each other. It is about faith seeking understanding, because the God we serve is the God who meets us at our points of need. The God we serve is a God who journeys with us from wherever we are. The God we serve is not a God who says, come up here and meet me, my friends. No, the God we serve is a God who comes down in Jesus and meets us in the trenches and meets us at a place of brokenness and meets us at a place where we are struggling and meets us at a place where we do not know where to go or where to come. That God meets us there. And that God picks us up, and that God carries us, and that God nurtures us, and that God encourages us, and that God waits for us. So there is a place for everyone in God's love. May the life of Pauline and the legacy of this great woman of God be a source of inspiration and blessing to the next generation. You, therefore, are the ones who must uphold her legacy and ensure that the generation not yet born are blessed by her life and her living. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us just spend a moment as we again hear from God in Jesus, who speaks directly to all of us in ways that only we can understand, nudges us to make the appropriate response. So God, oh God, we bless you in Jesus for who you are and for all that you have done and all that you are doing. May this word now sink deep in our hearts and position us to ensure that the Joshua generation steps up, to ensure that the Joshua generation carries the baton of faith and nation building and transformation of lives. Amen.
Please stand as we affirm our faith, as we pray together the Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Remain standing as we sing the hymn, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul."
Thank you.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Kindly be seated for prayer. Let us pray. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We bless your name for the life of Cynthia Pauline Thompson, whom we today lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing her life has brought to others, for her service to her generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of her life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed her all the days of her life, that now the trials of this world are over and death itself is past. Receive her into your perfect kingdom and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for redemption, we commend our sister Cynthia Pauline to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto her, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, ever and ever. Friends, a great hymn of the faith we refer to as the Methodist anthem, written by our founder, Charles, a hymn that has tremendously blessed generations of Methodists, including Pauline and her generation, a hymn that is deeply loved and has moved them again and again to surrendering their hearts, their lives, their all to the Lord. I met someone who loved music little more than I do, Pauline. And therefore, this service is a musical celebration of her life. And so we sing again to the glory of God. And you can clap your hands and stamp your feet as we serve and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused this pain? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?
Oh,
after the benediction, you're invited to remain standing as we sing the song Benediction, during which the president will lead. And then at the end of the hymn, we invite the pallbearers, who will then, we will proceed with the recessional. Receive the benediction. Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead, O Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen. Go, my children, with my blessing, never alone, waking, sleeping, I am with you. You are my own.
Children, live.
a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass. As the flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone. And the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon those who fear him, and his righteousness to the children's children. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass. As the flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone. The place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon those who fear him, and his righteousness to the children's children.
Jesus Christ. Amen. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord.
We join our voices, we sing the hymn, O love that will not let me go, I rest my weary soul in thee. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that he should be saved from all enemies and from the hands of all that hate us. Perform the mercy promised by our forefathers and to remember his holy covenant, to perform the oath which he sware to our forefathers Abraham that he would forgive us, that we being delivered out of the hand of our enemies might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And though child, shalt be called a prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people for the remission of their sins. Through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high have visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Let us continue in prayer. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so says the Spirit, for the rest from their labors. Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from death of sin to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant to the bereaved consolation and faith in this time of distress and trial, the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace and the fellowship of your people, and steadfastness in the service of your name and the doing of your will. So, Lord God, we commit the family members to you. And we ask, O God, that you will journey with them as you would have journeyed with Pauline during her lifetime. May they know that you are with them always, and that your promise is that you will never leave them nor forsake them. Lord God, carry them when they are unable to carry themselves. When they fall, pick them up. Give them all the grace that they need to be so led by your Spirit that their lives will make such an impact on the world that this world will be a better place because they lived. We know, God, in all of this, that they can face tomorrow because Jesus lives. Because he lives, he carries them. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen. Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world your hands have made, you see the stars, we hear the rolling thunder, thy works throughout the universe display, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Oh Lord, my God,
brother next to him? Does Jesus care?
Thank you. We are marching in the light of God. 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 We are marching, we are marching. In the light of God, we are marching, we are marching, marching, we are marching in the light of God. We are living in the love 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 of God. We are living, 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 living.
Oh, marching in,
oh, when the saints go marching.
Soon and very soon. Soon and very soon.
Soon.
Hold on.
on to thee. Hold on, hold on. My God, hold on. Oh, hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. I am determined to hold on to the end.
Amen. And Pauline held on to the end. And we are challenged and encouraged that as we go through this journey called life, that we too must hold on until this life transitions into life eternity. Receive the benediction. And now may the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with you. So God the Father bless you, God the Son save you, and God the Holy Spirit keep company with you, now and forevermore. And the people say, Amen, amen, and Amen. Thank you. Bless you.
You mean him, right?
Nice to meet you. I should say, favorite female Methodist minister.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. Beside you.
His presence go before, behind, beside, all around you, within you. He is here, He is here. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going,
you'll rejoice.
He is for,
He is for.
May the favor.
He is for.